out of war, people shouting in the square.
Our next guest, this is just to sign in again, this is Arthur Schwartz. The show is Advocating for Justice. We're on every Monday from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. on WBAI 99.5 FM. For those who are listening or on the radio at www.bai.org, we have a show where we talk about people who are organizing around issues and people who are running for office who support or are part of those who are running for who are organizing around issues. And our next guest this afternoon is Ray Rogers. Now, I can't even remember how long I've known Ray. Not as long as Tom, but probably going back to the mid-1980s when Ray was part of the sort of labor establishment for a while. He came up with this concept of the corporate campaign. Unions are prohibited from doing what they call secondary boycotts. Like you can't say don't shop at Macy's because they're carrying Farrah pants made by scab labor in New Mexico. So, and unions can lose a lot of money if they do things like that. So Ray came up with this whole concept of the corporate campaign, which was to go after the people on the boards of big corporations and that were doing wrongdoing all over the United States. And he did it on behalf of unions, and he did it on behalf of other campaigns. So it's like if Coca-Cola is killing workers in Central America, you go after the board members of Coca-Cola here in the United States, you picket their houses, you send them letters, you attack the corporations that they're part of. And Ray has really made a name for himself as a muckraker over the last 30 years or so. And Ray's sitting with me in the studio, and he has a new campaign, which is about fighting the REBNY bullies. REBNY is the Real Estate Board of New York. Good afternoon, Ray. And can you tell us what's the latest and how can people hear? What's it mean to fight REBNY, and what does it mean to our listeners?
Well, Art, thanks for having me here. The Real Estate Board of New York, we're called REBNY. More appropriately, it would be called the Real Estate Bullies of New York, ravaging every borough of New York City, as your previous guest was talking about, even down there in Staten Island. The way that the Real Estate Board of New York is very much behind a number of crises that this city and the state is facing. When we talk about the lack of affordable housing and the homelessness crisis, you can look right to REBNY. Why? REBNY is behind this hyper-gentrification on steroids, building all these high-rises where the mayor claims we're going to have mandatory affordable housing. But this is a joke. Affordable for who? The whole affordable housing program that Mayor de Blasio has is a joke. One can say, well, why do you say that? And why would he not stand up for poor and working people that he claimed he would in talking about the Tale of Two Cities? Just look at the campaign contributions that are going to the mayor or to the speaker, Melissa Margarita Viverito. The real estate interest through the Real Estate Board of New York has given the mayor, in a report that recently came out, about $2 million, 62% of his campaign contributions. Another 12% came from billionaires and bosses. With respect to the city council member, a report came out that called East Harlem for Sale, where she is my city council member, and where they talked about how the speaker collected $172,000 from real estate interests. But what are the other things that should be concerned to people involved in politics and Democratic politics and Bernie Sanders type of politics? Well, I'm sure many of you people may be aware of, and many of them won't be, with what's called the Independent Democratic Conference. This conference exists basically to keep, in many respects, to keep Republicans in control of the New York Senate, particularly as with respect to real estate interests. You have right now, REBNY, and a top conservative consultant said that there simply would not be a Republican majority in the New York State Senate if REBNY did not exist. There is no other business organization that's more important in the state. Well, REBNY puts a lot of money behind 8 candidates that make up the Independent Democratic Conference. And what they make sure is that a couple of things that the real estate board really wants and the real estate big interests want. Number one is they want to undermine rent stabilization, rent control laws, and undermine NYCHA housing, New York City Housing Authority, the public housing. Those are key. But they also want to keep the billions of dollars in corporate welfare, tax abatements, and subsidies coming into them, 421A, things like that. This is the way that the taxpayer ends up financing many of these big developers that are literally bulldozing neighborhoods and tearing the city apart. The other thing that a lot of people don't realize, and particularly with a large number of folks out there here in New York City, is that those who think that they're protected by rent stabilization, and I know you just mentioned with your earlier guest, hey, listen, all they got to do is shut a building down, there goes rent stabilized apartments, which many of these big developers are willing to do. But look at another thing. There is but almost one-third of the 800,000-plus rent-stabilized apartments in this city are all at threat. They're under what they call preferential rents. And by that, what do I mean by that? Well, when people go into these rent-stabilized buildings and they're told that they're going to get a deal, they're going to get a preferential rent, so they're not going to have to pay the market rate that has been registered with the state. So the landlord looks like they're being nice, give them a deal, so they go ahead and, they feel like they got a decent rent they can afford. And the next thing, what they don't realize is that under the preferential rent, when their lease is up, their rents don't come under the rent stabilized guidelines. They can go up hundreds or even thousands of dollars. They can go all the way up to what they registered as their maximum rent. So this is a real threat to over a quarter of a million people in rent stabilized buildings right now. What's another big problem?
Well, So we all know, everybody who listens to this station knows that the cost of housing is crazy in New York City, right? Whether you, particularly if you're a renter, and everybody also knows that rent-controlled apartments are pretty much done unless you're 90 years of age or older, or the child, or sort of lived with your parents until they were 80. Rent-stabilized apartments are getting lesser and lesser and lesser every year. Why is that happening? Why are we losing rent stabilized apartments? What's the process that causes that to happen?
Number one, we'll start out with greed. We'll start out with the kind of control that the Real Estate Board of New York has, the dominance over politics, the abuse of not only political power, but their economic power. We call them billionaire bullies. They're a bunch of bullies and racketeers that are the top policymakers of the Real Estate Board of New York, REBNY. Let me give an example. Another issue that REBNY is involved in, not only, undermining rent-stabilized buildings and protections for tenants that many groups are fighting back against, they also are very anti-labor. Construction in this anywhere is very dangerous. And what REBNY has done is they have fought, and very successfully, to undermine labor unions in the construction industry. At one time, 85-90% of construction was what we call closed shop. I know, Arthur, you understand what that is, but basically anybody on a construction job would have to be a member of the union. Today, you have maybe 30-50% that are closed. Everything's going open shop, okay? Almost everything is going open shop. And you have less and less union work being done. So REBNY is opposed to a closed shop for unions, but REBNY itself is a closed shop. A lot of people don't realize this. You have more than 75% of REBNY members are real estate agents and brokers. For them to work at any of these big real estate agencies, real estate brokerage houses, such as Douglas Elliman, the Corcoran Group, Halstead, they have to pay substantial dues to REBNY. And I have talked to dozens of these real estate agents and brokers when we're handing out a leaflet called Beware of REBNY, Real Estate Bullies Plague in New York, which, by the way, you can go to the website stoprebnybullies.org, and you not only can read this brochure that tells you a lot about REBNY and the people running it, you can also see a 5-minute animated film we produced called Bullies, which exposes REBNY. It's getting raving reviews. Again, go to stoprebnybullies.org. But again, when it comes to the union situation, not only are they trying to break the unions. They're also against what's called the prevailing wage, which is simply a wage on government jobs, which is set by the government, a fair wage for workers, and so that workers aren't pitted, union workers aren't pitted against non-union workers when it comes to contractors bidding on jobs. They want to do away with the prevailing wage. They also would like to bring in what we call the right to work, unions call right to work for less laws. These are these very, arch-conservative right-wing people that are totally anti-union, try to bring in laws to make it very difficult for unions to even exist. So this is what REBNY is all about.
So what is the campaign trying to do?
Before I say that, let me tell you what the campaign is trying to do. I want to add one thing so we understand who some of the big players are behind REBNY. These are the people that are saying that union construction workers make too much. We cannot go out and build these, you know, various buildings. Okay, union workers are too much. Well, some of the top policymakers, for example, are Stephen Ross. He's the head of Related Companies. This guy has been involved in tax, not just tax avoidance, but tax evasion. I would make a strong case for that. Some people wonder why he's not in jail. His net worth is $7.6 billion. Let's take a look at another one. Rob and Jerry Speier, the head of Tishman Speier, big developers here in New York. They're the folks that illegally deregulated thousands of rent-stabilized apartments in Stavistown and Peter Cooper Village in a scheme to steal millions of dollars from 27,000 tenants and to turn these apartments into high-priced condominiums. But let me tell you what they're doing right now. I mean, they should have been put out of business and in jail long ago just for that. Right now, they're building three towers in Long Island City, and it's been reported that they got $200 million in tax abatements to provide 20% affordable units out of 1,800 units that they're building.
What's that number again in tax abatements?
$200 million.
And that is abatements on the people that buy their apartments?
Yeah, these are tax abatements that they're getting to build the buildings. All right. Now, here's what has been reported.
$200 million. Three towers.
We're going to have 1,800 units. 20% should be affordable housing. But because of a loophole in the law, as has been reported in the press, they are going to provide no affordable housing, but they're going to keep the $200 million tax abatement. Now, there's something wrong with that. We know what that could do in terms of our schools. We know what it could do in terms of our public hospitals. We know what $200 million can do. It doesn't have to go into the pocket. You know whose pocket it's going into? It's going into Rob and Jerry Speier. Jerry Speier being the father, who used to be the head of REBNY. Rob Speier, by the way, is the chairman of REBNY right now. Their net worth, or his father's net worth, and his net, $3.9 billion. I'll give you another one. Jed and David Valentis, they used to be my landlords. They doubled my rent overnight. And Two Trees Management, well, Two Trees has also been involved in a lot of illegal activity, which I would call them criminals. I think they should also be in jail for the way they've cheated, rent-stabilized the tenants, and for the very bad safety conditions on a lot of their jobs, okay? What is their net worth? Their net worth is $2.1 billion. These are the people saying that we don't want construction workers. They also have done everything to undermine, you know, safety legislation.
Right, so
to protect.
If REBNY sounds like it's mostly a lobbying arm or a campaign, a thing to buy off politicians.
And that's what they do.
So by your campaign, what do you want? What's the goal of it?
Okay, the goal of
besides exposing it.
All right, the goal of the campaign is to greatly diminish. Okay, the abusive power, economic and political power of REBNY, all the way to making REBNY something that you wouldn't recognize that it is today. Let it exist to work with real estate agents and brokers, do the listings, help the is buying and selling of property, all the way to putting REBNY out of business. And what I would like to say to anybody who's big in Democratic politics and is concerned what is happening with REBNY and with these conservative Republicans and how they're undermining millions of people in terms of their jobs, in terms of their housing, I guarantee if anybody's got can write out some big checks to get behind the campaign to stop REBNY bullies, I will sit down with them and I will tell them how we can make REBNY a thing of the past. We can put them out of business. They're very vulnerable. Art, you were around when I created the corporate campaign concept, and something had took place that I was orchestrating that nobody said could ever happen. The reporters at the Wall Street Journal, Fortune, Forbes, Ray, you will never force the CEOs of these big Fortune 500 companies and big banks like Manufacturers Hanover and insurance companies like New York Life ever to resign from each other's boards of directors. And the big headlines in the newspapers from the New York Times to the Wall Street Street Journal, Fortune, and Forbes was another CEO resigns. I'm telling you right now, we're talking about confronting power with power. And it's one thing to become involved politically, but we need to take on these powerful concentrations of economic power that are the food and water supply to these politicians, like Mayor de Blasio, who I thought was going to be the greatest mayor this city ever saw it. Right now, I would have a very hard time voting for him. Same with Melissa Margaret Villarito. Nice on social issues, but when it comes down to economic and political power, they're keeping that power in the hands of outfits like Rebney, who are feeding them with a lot of cash so they can continue to be reelected and go on to higher office.
Again, Ray reminded me, I have to remind listeners that this is WBAI 99.5 FM. The show is Advocating for Justice, and this is listener-supported radio. We're able to bring you guests like Ray and Tom Sherbenko and many of the other wonderful people that have been on my show and other people's shows without a commercial, not a single commercial. And that's only done because members contribute money to support WBAI. This is listener-supported radio. There is a pledge line. Today, I'm just going to ask people to... last week, someone made a pledge to match any $27 donation. That pledge is still in place. So if people donate, that's the Bernie Sanders number, $27. People go to 516-620-3602. 516-620-3602. Or text WBAI 41444. That's WBAI 41444, or go to www.wbai.org and make a contribution. You will keep this radio station on the air because it only exists. We only have guests like Ray because this is listener-supported radio, not Rebney-supported radio, and we need your contributions. This show, you know, brings you some fairly interesting people that are not going to show up on MSNBC or CNN, but are on WBAI talking about how they're trying to, like, upend politics in America. And again, call in that pledge to 516-620-3602 or go to www.wbai.org. and make your pledge today. Okay, now our guest is Ray Rogers, who is talking about his campaign against Rebney. But tell us, what can people do? What are you asking people to do other than expose Rebney? What is the campaign designed to get our listeners to do?
The campaign has four facets to it. Let me tell you one thing they can help with right now. Right here, right now, we have 31 candidates, both in the primary and right now 16 who are in the general election, all right, who are holding up our brochure called Beware of Rebney Real Estate Bullies Plague in New York, which can be downloaded in black and white or color from our website, stoprebneybullies.org. These political candidates are having their posing for their photo with this flyer rebuking Rebney. So what I'd like everybody listening, if you have a candidate, your political candidate, your city council member, the borough president, whoever it is in your area, if you would look at our website, stoprebneybullies.org, call me at 718-852-2808, and look to see whether the candidates that you're familiar with have had their picture taken rebuking Rebney, because we would love to go ahead, get their photo, and put them up on our list. We have 31 right now, including mayoral candidate Sal Albanese, And we'd like to get as many of them as we can. I believe that we could get at least 80% of the candidates out there if we could reach out to them. Again, it's very important. We actually have two Republican city council candidates on this list that are rebuking Rebney. And I'm sure that there are many other Republicans as well as Democrats.
Now, how much of the problem sits with government in New York City, and how much of it sits with government in Albany? Because a lot of the rent laws and how they function, and even the renewal of the 421A program, which is a program which gives tax abatements in return for allowing certain percentage of affordable housing, is a law that was passed in Albany. So how much of the problem is a New York City problem, and how much of it is an Albany problem?
Well, there's a lot of it's an Albany problem, and one of the big problems in Albany, quite frankly, is the governor. Okay, and when I talk about the governor, the one thing about the Independent Democratic Conference is all about the governor working with some Democrats to keep the Republicans in power. And keeping them in power is affecting a lot of people's lives from very progressive legislation. If you want to talk about being a progressive, we've got a governor and an independent Democratic conference that are really preventing the kind of legislation that would protect a lot of people with respect to their housing, with respect to labor laws and labor protections. So Albany, there's a real problem. I mean, the one thing the mayor points out when he talks about the problems in with the transit system, well, wait a minute, that's controlled by Albany. Well, you know, it is. I mean, the major funding, but believe me, the leadership here in New York City has a great deal influence as to that the subway system could be better. But the major money and everything comes from Albany, a lot of the decisions they control. It's a situation where the key thing is if you have candidates, Democrat candidates here in New York City, you got to make sure that they're willing to stand up to Albany themselves. And again, a number of these people in the IDC, they're from New York City.
So I'm gonna tell you a little bit about yesterday. I spent the day at a conference of the New York Progressive Action Network, which is an entity that I helped create out of the Bernie Sanders campaign here in New York, and NYPAN is it's called. NYPAN has chapters that go from Buffalo all the way to Riverhead. We have 29 chapters and 10 affiliates. We had a conference yesterday, and it was in some way the kickoff of a campaign both to find a candidate that can defeat Governor Cuomo next year and to build efforts in many districts against the IDC. These are Democrats who caucus with the Republicans in the state Senate, which many people feel keeps a lot of decent legislation plugged up, although I don't know if it would get past the governor if it got past the Senate.
But I understand one thing, Arthur. The IDC, when it comes to what the real estate interests want, they get it.
Right. They get funded by real estate interests. But a lot of people, when they hear about the IDC and the role that they play, it isn't apparent to a lot of people, because there was a Siena poll recently asking about the IDC, and most people didn't know who they were and didn't have any particular negative opinion about them. But there is, just listeners should know, there is a, because in my opinion, the key bad player in terms of favoring the real estate interests in the city, in the state of New York, is the governor. Governor Cuomo, who has $25 million in his account, takes millions of dollars from real estate developers and has intentionally kept the legislature from really enacting stronger laws that favor people who need affordable housing. And the situation around the state is very similar to the situation in New York, with more and more people not being able to afford housing, with a growing homelessness crisis, not just in the city, even though the governor attacks Mayor de Blasio. And there were a few possible candidates standing in front of us yesterday who were not afraid to take on the governor. There was Mayor Stephanie Miner from Syracuse, who sounded awful lot like a candidate. There was a guy named Terry Gibson, who was a state senator from Ulster County. First time his county had ever voted for a Democrat. He won during the Obama years, and he sounded a whole lot like a guy running for office. And then there was a guy named Mike Gianaris, who is the head of the Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee and a state senator from Queens. But Mike, at the end of his speech, said, he was talking a lot about the IDC, said, you know, there's an interesting confluence. The day the IDC was founded was the day that Andrew Cuomo was sworn into office. And Andrew Cuomo could do a lot to end the influence of the IDC in Albany. So there is a growing movement, and I think that my view is that although the city council races are coming up, and it's great that you have people pledged to stand against Rebney in the city council, that has to be taken next year to a fight statewide, both to elect people who run against the IDC and to elect a new governor.
I totally agree with you. And we are planning on doing that. Okay, we do want to make this statewide. Right now, with the elections in New York City, I think we got a good start. But again, we need support. So anybody, again, that would like to support us, you can contact me at Ray Rogers at 718-852-2808. Go to our website, stoprebnybullies.org. And again, Governor Cuomo does not want to see the disbandment of the IDC. Obviously, he's one of their great allies. And again, the IDC, the reason it exists and the reason that Republicans are able to maintain control of the Senate is because of the money that REBNY is putting into the IDC. REBNY is the big financial backer behind all these candidates. That's the big money behind them. They are the driving force behind these candidates.
I want to thank Ray Rogers for the time he spent with us this afternoon on Advocating for Justice. We will be back next Monday at 5 o'clock. And one of our guests is going to be Assistant District Attorney Fleedner, who is running a write-in campaign against Cyrus Vance, the man who decided that he wasn't necessary to prosecute the Trump children or to prosecute Harvey Weinstein when evidence of him sexually assaulting a young woman came into his office. There was outrage about Cyrus Vance, and Mark Fleedner is running against him, and he's going to come onto our show next week and try to promote his write-in campaign. And we've also invited Dan Cord, who's an assembly member from the Upper East Side of Manhattan, who is on Vance's behind. So thank you. Please tune in next Monday from 5 to 6, Advocating for Justice.
Saturday, October 28th, the Southeast Queens Federal Credit Union is hosting a dinner theater party at the Black Spectrum Theater in Queens. The play is The Kingfish, a musical comedy based on the 1950s TV comedy show Amos and Andy that takes place in present-day Harlem. Dinner is at 6 p.m. The play starts at 8. The Black Spectrum Theater is located at 177th Street and Baisley Boulevard in Jamaica, Queens. For tickets and more information, call Liz Blaney at 917-294-0895.
My name's Chris Hedges. I'm the author with the cartoonist Joe Sacco of Days of Destruction, Days of Revolt. And when Joe and I are in New York, we always listen to WBAI 99.5 or WBAI.org because we want to stay informed and not get fed the commercial lies of the corporate media.